Hi guys, how are you? I wanted to show you how to use the solubility table. This is something we're going to learn later in the class, but for some reason it shows up here in the lab report 3. And so I thought I'd just show you really quickly how to use this thing. It's actually pretty cool. The first thing you need to know about the solubility, okay, so this thing is called the solubility table. Okay. And what's cool about a solubility table is when you put a solid in water, one of two things can happen. The solid can, you stir it up and the solid never dissolves, okay? Or you could stir it up and the solid will dissolve completely. And so then the water will look like clear, you know, water again. So some substances seem to dissolve really easily and other substances, they don't seem to dissolve at all. Now keep in mind that there's always a limit. So like even something that's very soluble in water, if you add enough of it, it will eventually, it won't dissolve anymore. But the solubility table helps you sort of predict whether something will be soluble or not in water. And again, this is just a prediction. The only way to tell if something is soluble or not is to actually go out into lab and try it. But as you'll learn in Chem 60, one of the big goals that we have in this class is that you can predict what will happen with chemicals before you do the experiment. You know, why do an experiment that someone's already done before? You can save time. That's kind of the whole point of chemistry, is saving time so that you can work on the new problems and not spend your whole life working on problems that people have already done before. That's how progress occurs. So the solubility table is easy to do. It only works with ionic compounds. So we'll refresh our memory of what an ionic compound is. But if you do recall, our definition from way back a couple weeks ago was that an ionic compound is a metal with a nonmetal. So let's just take any ionic compound. Let's take, for example, potassium chloride, KCl. Okay, so how do we use the solubility table? The first thing you do is you look for the first substance in the ionic compound. In that case, it's K. So remember, KCl, there's two substances that are being combined. K is potassium and Cl is chlorine. Okay, so first things first, we'll look for potassium. And so look on this side of the solubility table and look for potassium. Do you see potassium anywhere? Aha, potassium is here. So if you see potassium on the left side of the solubility table, and by the way, never look on this side, don't look on the right side, that's for later. Okay, we're just looking on the left side. Once we find potassium, oh, good news. It's soluble. Anything with potassium is soluble. We just now need to check on the right side for that row and make sure there's no exceptions. In this case, there's no exceptions for those ions, including potassium, so KCl would be said to be soluble. Okay, why don't we try silver chloride? Okay, there's another ionic compound. Silver is our metal, chloride is our non-metal. And so what we'll do here is we'll look for silver. Do we see silver anywhere? Ag, we're looking for Ag first. Nope, no Ag there. No Ag here, no Ag here. Keep looking. All right, there's no Ag anywhere on the left. And remember, I'm not looking anywhere on the right. That's irrelevant for now. Just looking on the left, we need to find one of those two things on the left. Okay, next up, we're gonna look for chloride. Can we find chloride? Not there. Ah, there's chloride. Chloride is on the left. Good news, that means silver chloride is soluble. Just one last thing. We need to check over here and make sure there's no exceptions. Oh no, chloride is soluble except silver is listed as one of the exceptions. That's bad news. Okay, so that means silver chloride is insoluble. We were close. We had chloride, which is usually soluble, but one of the exceptions is chloride with silver is insoluble. Okay, let's do one more. Let's do barium hydroxide. Hydroxide is a polyatomic ion. A polyatomic ion, if you break it down, what it means is poly means more than one. So poly means many, it's a Greek prefix. And atomic means atoms. So if something is a polyatomic ion, that means it's an ion that's formed with more than one atom. Most ions are just one atom, like chloride or potassium or silver. But some ions are polyatomic, meaning they're formed with two or more atoms, like hydroxide. So this is barium hydroxide. We'll learn about polyatomic ions in a little bit. Okay, let's look for barium. Do we see barium anywhere on the left? No, we don't. If you look at all those things on the left, there's no barium. Okay, now let's look for OH, hydroxide. Do we see hydroxide anywhere? Yes, there's hydroxide way down here at the bottom. And interesting to note that this is in the bottom part of the left-hand column. Our compounds containing these ions are insoluble. That means if that's bad news, right? If it has hydroxide, that means it's insoluble. So it's opposite of what's going on up here, where if you have any of these ions, this compound is soluble, but anything down here is going to be insoluble. Okay, so we're going to say barium hydroxide is insoluble. We just need to check our exceptions. Now, these exceptions are actually going to make the compound soluble because we're in the insoluble bottom row. And let's take a look here. It says S2 minus or OH minus. Oh, there's our OH minus paired with strontium, barium, or calcium. Oh, barium is an exception, making the compound soluble. So we were going to say this was insoluble because it had hydroxide, but barium is an exception, making it soluble. So that means this is going to be soluble. All right, so now you should do this table with the compounds that you used in part two of experiment three. So for example, in like part one of experiment three, I think you take something like barium chloride and you add it to water. So you should apply the solubility table and determine if barium chloride is soluble or not. And does that match the results in experiment three? And what do I mean, does it match the results in experiment three? Well, look at the video in experiment three. When you mix barium chloride in water, did it fully dissolve or was there a cloudiness? If something becomes cloudy after you mix it, then that's meaning it's not dissolving. It's staying sort of suspended in the water and not dissolving. So that would be said to be insoluble. But if you shake something up and it gets clear, then that means it's soluble. So that's the experimental way to determine if something is soluble or not. And then this is sort of the data table calculation way to determine if something's soluble or not, sort of a rough back of the envelope prediction. So what you will find is that usually, but not always, the solubility table will match what you observe experimentally. There was a few other compounds in part two. For example, there was a sodium sulfate. So you'll want to use the solubility table to determine if that is soluble. And I think there was one more compound you want to check out in part two. So just for the post lab in experiment three, part two, you just want to sort of list the compounds of interest and mention something like, in the solubility table, barium chloride is predicted to be soluble. Or you would say, in the solubility table, barium chloride is predicted to be insoluble, whatever you predict. And then you'll want to make a comment that says like, this is consistent with what I saw in the video, or this is inconsistent with what I saw in the video. Okay, hopefully that clears up some things about the solubility table. And if you have any more questions at all, just come to my office hours and I'll be happy to help you. Okay, good luck. See you next week.